Hey everyone, I'm Vikram Salunke and welcome to the X86 assembly course. So in this course, we are going to focus on 32-bit systems because there are still plenty of 32-bit systems available and it will be easier for us to move on to the 64-bit systems. So these topics we are going to cover. We'll start with the numbering systems, then computer organization and architectures. Then we'll look at the architecture for 32-bit systems on an Intel processor. Then we'll look at basics of C programming. Then we'll convert C code to the assembly language. Then we'll move on to the registers, memory. We'll understand how the stack works. Then different instructions on x86 32-bit assembly language. Then we'll write our own assembly code on Windows as well as on Linux format. Okay, so let's get started. First, numbering systems. So the first numbering system is decimal system. Next one is a binary system. And the last one we are going to look at is a hexadecimal system. The decimal system, the value for a digit is 0 to 9. So the base is 10 here. What do you mean by a base? Base is a maximum number of symbols that can be assigned to a single digit. That means to a single digit, we can assign 10 different types of a symbol from 0 to 9, right? So 156 number is an example of a decimal system. Next, we'll look at the binary system. In the binary system, digit value is either 0 or 1. That means the base is 2 here. So this is the example of a binary system. Computer systems generally operate using a binary logics. They just know only 0 or 1. Next, we'll look at the hexadecimal system. In the hexadecimal system, the digit value is 0 to 9 and A, B, C, D, E, F. So the base is 16. That means we can assign 16 different symbols to a single digit. Example is A, B, 1, 2. And this can be represented as 0, X, A, B, 1, 2. Why we need an hexadecimal system? Because it's really simple to convert hexadecimal number to its binary equivalent and vice versa. Okay, so this is a conversion table for hexadecimal to binary, right? So it will start from 0 to the F. As we can see, 0 will convert to 0000 and 1 is converted to 0001 till F will convert to 1111. Right? Now we'll look at how to convert a binary number to a hexadecimal number. So this is a binary number. What we'll do, we'll first group the 4 bits, then we'll look at the table, and then we convert a 4 binary bits to its hexadecimal equivalent. So 1100 is C, 0011 is 3, 1111 is F and 0101 is 5, right? So we'll look at how to convert hexadecimal number to its binary equivalent. We will look at the table once again. 9 belongs to the 1001, A belongs to the 1010, 3 will convert to 0011, and F will convert to 1111, right? So this is how we can convert a binary number to its hexadecimal number and hexadecimal number to a binary number, right? Now we'll move on to the data type. The first data type is a bit. It's either 0 or 1. The second one is a byte. So 8 bits equal to 1 byte. Similarly, 16 bits is word. 32 bits is double word, 64 bits is a quad word, and 128 bits is double quad word, right? So this is a binary number. So the rightmost bit number at the zeroth position is known as the least significant bit. Leftmost bit is known as the most significant bit, right? Okay. Now we'll move on to the computer organization and architecture. So the most important part in computer organization and architecture is a CPU. CPU is the brain of a computer. Another part is input devices, such as our keyboard, mouse, scanner, etc. Then comes main memory, known as a RAM. Then comes the output devices, such as monitor, printers, etc. And last one is our auxiliary storage, our disk drives, such as hard disk drives, etc. So these all parts are connected by a system bus, right? Now we look at the CPU. The first part of the CPU is known as the control unit. So control unit is responsible for to retrieving and decoding instructions, as well as retrieving and storing data into the main memory. Next one is known as the execution unit. So it is responsible for execution of an instruction. Next one is known as the registers. So the registers are the internal memory locations. So we can use them as a variables. And the last one are the flags. So flag indicates different events when executing instructions, right? Now we'll look at the registers. So what is a register? Register is a small memory storage that is built into the processor. It is a volatile memory. So in the x86-32 systems, registers are 32 bits. And in the 64 systems, registers are 64 bits. Okay. Now we'll look at the Intel architecture 32 bit, known as i32. Okay. So there are general purpose registers, segment registers, flags EIP, floating point unit registers, MMX registers, and XMM registers. So by the time we'll only focus on general purpose registers and EIP. Other register we'll see when we need them. Okay. So first we'll start with the general purpose registers. So EAX register is used to store the function return value. EBX stores base pointer to the data section. ECX is a counter for a string and a loop operation. EDX is IO pointer. ESI is a source pointer for a string operation. EDI is a destination pointer for a string operation. ESP is a stack pointer. And EBP is a stack frame base pointer. I know it's sounding a little bit confusing, but soon we're going to see them in action. Then you'll understand them clearly, right? Next, we'll look at the EIP. So EIP stores the pointer to the next instruction to be executed, right? Known as the instruction pointer. Okay. Now, as I said earlier, in 32-bit systems, all register, general purpose registers are 32-bit, right? So the EAX is 32-bit, EBX is 32-bit, ECX is 32-bit, EDX is 32-bit, right? So we will access the lower order of EAX using AX, as well as we can access the lower byte of AX using AL, or we can access the higher byte of AX using AH. Similarly, we can access the lower word of EBX using BX, as well as lower byte of BX using BL, and the higher byte of BX using BH. The case is similar for this ECX and EDX, right? So ESP, EBP, ESI, and EDI, those are also 32-bit. And we can access the lower word of ESP using the SP. We can access the lower word of EBP using the BP. We can access the lower word of ESI using the SI, as well as we can access the lower word of EDI using the DI. Okay, so EIP is also 32-bit. And we can access its lower word using the IP. That's what I have planned for this video. I hope you liked it. So if you have any feedbacks, any doubts, etc., you can contact me at my email ID vikram@vmaskers.com, or you can tweet me at vikramsalunke20. Thank you.